good is.
Hey, sweet fire.
Solo stove.
Cool.
Well, you two starting cigars and liquor without me?
Oh, there you go. Courtesy of Robert Himber.
Ah, yeah, the survival instructor. He passed away. What a shame. What a shame.
Let me guess, you want some Crown.
Was there ever any doubt in your mind?
No.
Okay.
That's why there's so much of it.
Oh, you got a cutter? Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
I'll pass that down.
Yeah.
Getting kind of cool out tonight, isn't it?
Fire feels good.
Yes, it does. Flip top.
So why did you call this meeting, Jefe?
Can't you see I'm busy?
At least he's not grumpy.
Not yet.
Why are you here? Who is he?
Your grandson.
You look about like you're 12. Actually, call this little meeting because we got some questions from some viewers that want some, what I think is pertinent information. And I think you guys are the right ones to answer this. Well, you're the right one to answer this.
Well, and I appreciate
that. It's good
that.
You brought somebody with you, okay? So what I thought we'd do is like kind of throw these things out at you and you guys give me your thoughts. And I'd really like to hear what you guys got to say. Is that cool?
Absolutely.
All right, good
Sounds
deal.
Good.
First thing that comes up, and this is a pretty good question. What are the differences between students that are law enforcement versus students that are private or legally armed citizens? I'm not sure there is a difference. What do you guys think?
I think there's a difference in that law enforcement officers are a little more difficult to teach because they tend to think that they know perhaps more than they do.
The whole show me thing. Mm. Yeah, yeah. Not a bad idea. Wes, do you go about... Well, I mean, there's going to be different applications, but when we're talking about nuts and bolts, the foundational type skills, do you see a big difference in how they're taught?
No, I think a lot of it's in the application of the skills because, you know, one group is, you know, personal self-defense slash just enthusiast, and the other one is the one most likely to have to use the skills. So kind of the mindset of how we're going about it's a little bit different.
You know, when I see, since I've started, I'm like you for... The vast majority of my adult life, it was law enforcement training.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit of military here and there. In the last 9 years since I've been doing more armed citizens, I have found that there is a little bit of a difference. And the difference actually comes in the fact that, you know, law enforcement doesn't kill the enemy. They police society. Thus, their goal is to take people into custody. So many, maybe the majority, of their confrontations are extremely close because they tend to happen during that arrest situation.
The officer's responding.
Right. Armed
reacting.
Citizens, not so much. They're back a little bit. It's a conversational distance, you know, more like a 5 or 6 yard distance where they're across the width of a car or the length of a parking space or in their driveway. Whereas the cop is actually in there snatching onto somebody, so quite often their shooting start as a fight.
Mm.
Where an armed citizen starts as a conversation or a confrontation.
Well, and as an armed citizen, there's that opportunity and hopefully the forethought to avoid. And many times with the law enforcement officer, it's the statutory obligation. You're there. You've got a responsibility. You can't leave.
You know, when it comes to disarming, we talk about if a private citizen is accosted, someone sticks a gun in their face, they probably want something from that person. So there's this verbiage that they can use. Hey, please don't hurt me. They put their hands in a tactically sound position so they can move offline and grab the gun. Mm-hmm. A cop, if you have a gun in your face, it's probably about to be fired. Right. There's no negotiation. So definitely different.
You know, something else I've noticed? I've taken some of the classes from some of the former special operations and military guys, and I've noticed in their classes, they do a lot of long distance pistol shooting, what I would call 25 yards and out.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of struck me that's the military. They try to kill the enemy from great distance. So guys from that type of background, it only makes a certain amount of sense that they'll try to stretch the distance out on that handgun.
Sure. Sure.
As we all realize with active shooters and things like that, being able to use that pistol a little further away is a good idea. But let me ask you, Wes, how far is too far with a pistol, and at what point should you just leave?
No, beyond that 25-yard mark. You had some sort of alternatives. I mean, for starters, more than anything else, that's the gun that we struggle with the most, mm-hmm. you know, and it's the one with the greatest liability behind it. So making a good decision when those distances get a little bit further, I think, is important.
Mm-hmm. Your specialty is kind of close-quarter pistol craft and, you know, intertwining open-hand skills with handguns. What do you think?
I think that we assume, since a handgun fires a projectile, that our handgun encounters are going to be at distance, even 7 yards, 10 yards, 15 yards. Leoka stats don't bear that out. 0 to 10 feet is where 50% of the cops are killed every year, not 1 year, but for decades.
Yeah, yeah.
And 0 to 5 feet being the highest, you know, the deadliest range there, 0 to 5 feet.
That taking how custody much, distance.
How much do private citizens train 0 to 5 feet with a pistol? Mm-hmm. And the naive response is, well, if I can hit from 100 yards, hitting from 5 feet is that much easier, but we all know that's not
there's
the case.
There's no pandemonium, there's no duress, there's no blood, the mud, and the beer kind of thing
right.
going on.
Yeah, it's a night and day comparison.
Yeah, absolutely.